Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Taking America Back for God, Christian Nationalism in the United States, by Andrew L. Whitehead and Samuel L. Perry, narrated by Tom Parks. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. In the imagination of the simple patriot, the nation is not a society, but society. Though its values are relative, they appear, from his naive perspective, to be absolute. The nation is always endowed with an aura of the sacred, which is one reason why religions, which claim universality, are so easily captured and tamed by national sentiment, religion and patriotism merging in the process. Reinhold Niebuhr, Moral Man and Immoral Society. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. Preface. Most Americans who watch the news or scroll through social media could quickly list the most salient cultural and political issues currently driving a wedge down the middle of the United States: immigration reform, mass shootings, climate change, military spending, terrorism, gun control, travel bans, refugees, political correctness, opioid addiction, public education, racial injustice in policing, redefinitions of marriage and the family, secularism, transgender rights, single-parent households, and of course, Donald Trump. It doesn't take a social scientist to identify the sticking points in our country. The more contentious debate, rather, is over what connects those dots. What has us so increasingly and uniformly divided on those issues? Ask 10 social scientists to explain that to you, and you may get 10 different theories. There aren't any simple answers to that question, unfortunately. There are a myriad of historical, demographic, economic, and technological factors contributing to our increasing polarization on issues of race, family, religion, gender, human rights, the environment, taxes, and so on. There is no silver bullet explanation, and we don't intend to offer one here. Our goal in this book is to thoroughly explore one factor that, as we will show, plays a large, unique, but often unrecognized and at times misrecognized role in our nation's current cultural and political conflicts. That factor is Christian nationalism. Some conceptual clarifications would be helpful at the onset. Though journalists and historians have bandied about the term a good deal in the past decade, we mean Christian nationalism to describe an ideology that idealizes and advocates a fusion of American civic life with a particular type of Christian identity and culture. We use Christian here in a specific sense. We are not referring to doctrinal orthodoxy or personal piety. In fact, we find some Christian nationalists can be quite secular. Rather, the explicit ideological content of Christian nationalism comprises beliefs about historical identity, cultural preeminence, and political influence. But just as important, it also contains ideological content that is often implicit. This includes symbolic boundaries that conceptually blur and conflate religious identity: Christian, preferably Protestant, with race, white, nativity, born in the United States, citizenship, American, and political ideology, social and fiscal conservative. Christian nationalism, then, provides a complex of explicit and implicit ideals, values, and myths, what we call a cultural framework, through which Americans perceive and navigate their social world. What do we not mean by Christian nationalism? First, and this may surprise or disappoint some readers, this isn't a book about white evangelicals. Certainly, we will address the considerable overlap between Christian nationalism and white evangelicalism. But the two concepts are not at all synonymous. Christian nationalism is a framework that orients Americans' perspectives on national identity, belonging, and social hierarchies. American evangelicalism, strictly speaking, is a theological tradition prioritizing certain doctrinal commitments, including biblical inerrancy and conversionism. While a large percentage of Christian nationalists are affiliated with evangelical Protestant denominations and hold characteristically evangelical beliefs, many non-evangelicals, or non-Christians for that matter, also hold strong Christian nationalist beliefs. Conversely, many white evangelicals in surveys unequivocally reject Christian nationalism, including a number of the white evangelicals we interviewed for this book. Second, occasionally people have been confused by the term nationalism, which we do not strictly mean in the chauvinistic sense of blindly believing that one's nation is superior to others. Though strong Christian nationalists would no doubt hold that sentiment about America, Christian nationalists do tend to be more nationalistic. We mean something more like Christian nationism, or what sociologist Rogers Brubaker calls Christianism, a commitment to a vision of American civic life and polity as closely intertwined with an identitarian, politically conservative strain of Christianity. We also want to distinguish Christian nationalism from theocracy, as people commonly think of that term. Reformed camps of evangelicals debate different philosophies of church-state relations, using terms like theonomy and two-kingdom theology, and neo-Kipparianism, but these are fights among theological elites. Those views are not widespread like the more populist Christian nationalism. While there is indeed some technical overlap between the goals of strong Christian nationalists and theocrats, some key distinctions deserve mention. Strictly theocratic Christians would want the Bible principally to inform our national laws. To the contrary, some Christian nationalists are not only fond of our founding documents, many believe they are divinely inspired, not quite as authoritative as the Bible, but still supernaturally revealed to Christian men with intentions to preference Christianity. Moreover, while theocracy often implies that religious leaders, even clergy in some manifestations, play a central role in governance, Christian nationalists, it turns out, are quite willing to elect notoriously impious heads of state if they happen to support right-wing causes. One staunch Christian nationalist, in fact, famously articulated what has become a popular refrain used to defend the religious vote for Donald Trump: "We're electing a president, a commander-in-chief, not a pastor-in-chief." Two more points of clarification. This book will provide the first empirical examination of contemporary Christian nationalism in the United States. Dozens of books written by sober-minded historians, political scientists, and historical comparative sociologists trace the Christian American narrative from when Europeans set foot on the continent to the American Revolution and subsequent attempts to redefine and institutionalize America's collective identity as a Christian nation, to modern-day movements to make the Founding Fathers seem like card-carrying members of the religious right. The literature is massive and growing. We have no intention of adding another historical analysis, as we feel our greater contribution will be to document, analyze, and understand Christian nationalism in its most recent manifestation. Consequently, we will only reference the long history of Christian nationalism to the extent that it directly informs our national situation within the past decade. Readers interested in more historical background should follow our notes. Along with our contemporary focus, we also limit our analyses to American Christian nationalism. Sociologists like Roger Brubaker, Lydia Bean, and Bart Bonikowski, and political scientists J. Christopher Soper and Joel Fetzer have produced vital comparative analyses of nationalism, religion, and populism. These scholars and others continue to document nationalist movements across the world in response to perceived demographic and cultural threats from a variety of sources. These movements have incorporated, among other things, a narrative about national religious identities in order to draw symbolic boundaries around cultural membership, similar to what we will observe among Christian nationalists in the United States. We acknowledge at the outset there are many international parallels to what we observe in this book. However, we also believe that an exclusive focus on American Christian nationalism is not unjustified, because there is such an historic and enduring connection between conservative Christianity and American civic life and polity, one that is almost wholly denuded in most of Europe. We encourage readers to consider our work in conversation with these other important studies. A brief word about the examples we cite. Throughout the book, we illustrate our arguments about Christian nationalism by drawing upon events on the national stage and quotes from political and religious leaders. We fully expect that some of the examples we provide may appear older or outdated by the time readers are able to hold this volume. It seems as though the news cycle continues to contract, and what was once front-page news is almost forgotten a week later, let alone months later. This places us at a disadvantage when writing a book. We would ask readers to keep in mind, however, that our goal is not to illustrate our points using the latest breaking news. Our journalist friends and colleagues already do that quite well. We endeavor to show how our underlying arguments about Christian nationalism can be applied to those events that are breaking news, whatever they may be, and whenever they may have happened. We hope the examples we use that took place while we were writing this book equip readers to look and listen for Christian nationalist rhetoric and understand its dramatic influence on the actions, decision, and speech of those around us in the present moment. Finally, in the words that follow, we present findings concerning Christian nationalism that may cause consternation among some readers. As social scientists, our goal is to use high-quality and transparent methods to gather and analyze data, and then truthfully present what we find in the data. We are confident that what we present isn't a fluke. In Appendix B, we share dozens of tables so readers can check our work. For those readers who find themselves troubled by what support for the core tenets of Christian nationalism is associated with, we encourage them to think deeply with us about why that is and consider if there is a better way forward. We hope all begin to consider if and how the dictates of the Christian religion may stand in opposition to those used to defend a Christian nation. Finally, we caution against writing off most of those on the other side, whichever side that may be. In the hours we spent talking with American men and women from around the country, we were reminded that beneath the quantitative findings are people with complicated histories, desires, and viewpoints. The more we can talk and work to truly listen, the greater the chances of building a civil society where all can flourish, not just a few. Introduction. A House Dividing. The sanctuary was bursting with stars and stripes, draped from the balcony, lining the stage, printed on the identical ties and scarves worn by the 100-person choir and full orchestra. An image of the Bible resting on Old Glory was displayed on all the screens throughout this conservative Baptist church in South Carolina, including the overflow area which was quickly filling up. The balcony and ground floor of the sanctuary were already at capacity. The God and Country celebration would be starting soon, and it was clear that both God and Country were equally sacred in this place. After one particularly rousing part of the worship service, in which the choir and orchestra performed anthems from each branch of the armed forces, the MC, in full military uniform, intoned, "We would be remiss if we did not mention God, author and perfecter of our faith. He's guided and protected this country throughout its history. Any victories we claim are all because of him and his faithfulness. And, in the good times and bad, he's always been on our side." Earlier in the day, across town, a much larger Baptist congregation held a similar Celebrate America service. During this service, the entire congregation pledged allegiance first to the United States flag, then to the Christian flag, and third to the Holy Bible. Actors representing various founding fathers and decked out in historically themed costumes recited lines proclaiming America's special relationship with God. Throughout the service, the leaders and congregants lamented that the United States failed in its devotion to God's laws and principles. This backsliding had caused God to withdraw his hand of blessing. But out of this darkness, they declared, there shines a bright light. As the MC, also in military uniform, exclaimed, "Jesus alone has the power to change our nation. He gave the ultimate sacrifice for our lives and for our nation." Halfway across the country in Oklahoma, on the same day, a similar Freedom Celebration service was in full swing. The senior pastor began his message, entitled "America, an Exceptional Nation," by confronting the pernicious myth about the country's secular roots. Referencing political operative and self-proclaimed historian David Barton, whose ministry, Wall Builders, supplies quotes and factoids for services just like this one, the pastor proclaimed that anyone who questions the Christian heritage of the United States would need to ignore scores of original letters and documents from the founding fathers. Deniers of our heritage would also have to go to Washington, D.C., and take a sandblaster and remove the scriptures from the monuments and the buildings. It's all there. Beaming with pride, the pastor boasted that his church frequently hosts a Reclaiming America for Jesus Christ conference, though he'd begun to wonder recently whether America really can be reclaimed. For that to happen, he proposed, Americans must remember their Christian past while living like Christians in the present. Only then would God make their country prosperous. America has to be blessable for God to shed his grace on thee. He closed his sermon with a solemn charge, citing an Old Testament verse upon which Dwight D. Eisenhower placed his hand while taking his inaugural oath, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. "If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land." The pastor then whispered, "The key word in this promise is that word, if." These July 4th worship services reflect more than a particular understanding of American history. The symbols they hold sacred, the narratives they retell, the charges they make, all express a specific vision of Christianity's relationship to American identity and civic life. And it is one that seems to be increasingly at odds with the views of the rest of the nation, and self-consciously so. To be sure, most Americans are somewhere in the fuzzy middle on these issues. They recognize America's vaguely Judeo-Christian past and Christianity's numerical dominance in the United States. But they also celebrate the ideal of religious freedom and believe church-state separation to be a good thing. And yet, it sometimes appears that Americans are gravitating toward extremes on these topics. A growing number of more secular Americans, for example, maintain that both Christianity and America's public institutions are at their best when the two function like considerate neighbors, friendly in their interactions, but always respecting the boundaries between them. Toward the other end of the spectrum, however, an equally large group of Americans, the kind who attend services like those we just described, insist that since its inception, the United States has been married to Christianity. As these services we attended made clear, the Christian God has always been on our side. His Son Jesus gave his life for our nation, and our prosperity is contingent upon our returning to him. Those who hold this opinion are often quick to cite evidence of this covenantal relationship in America's founding ideals, historic documents, sacred symbols, policies, and elsewhere. Most importantly, both America and Christianity, they argue, have benefited greatly from that union. And consequently, those who wish to dissolve the marriage want nothing less than to destroy America. This book is about the underlying causes and social consequences of this latter view, what we and others call Christian nationalism. Is America a Christian nation? Why, the answer does and doesn't matter. What is Christianity's relationship to American identity and civic life? What should it be? While these are interesting historical, theological, and political questions, they aren't necessarily questions social science can or should answer. Many books seek to test particular claims about the Christian heritage of the United States. However, the answer to whether the United States ever was or still is a Christian nation is not the focus of this book. Rather, we focus on how these beliefs, whether strongly held or barely acknowledged, influence the lives of those who hold them as well as those who do not. Taking this angle, it becomes clear that it does not even matter whether the United States is or ever was a Christian nation. What matters is that a significant number of Americans believe that it is, and a significant number believes the opposite. The particular stance people take on this issue is strongly associated with how they see the world, as well as how they act to preserve or change that world. Therefore, the contention that the United States is a Christian nation has implications for us all, even for those Americans who reject such interpretations. The stakes are high. For example, a large percentage of Americans who favor Christian nationalist views, which we will detail further, believe that the American government should unapologetically privilege Christianity. Robert Jeffress, a megachurch pastor and member of Donald Trump's Evangelical Advisory Board, argues, "The framers of the Constitution and the earliest jurists demonstrated a clear preference for Christianity. They did not hesitate to declare that America was a Christian nation. The government can, and for more than 150 years did, show a preference for the Christian faith." To the extent that such views become reflected in public policy, the growing percentage of Americans who are not Christian will undoubtedly feel ostracized, treated as though they are not fully American. These groups fear that explicitly privileging Christian identity, symbols, and doctrines, according to any number of interpretations, will threaten their access to civil society in more tangible ways. And they would be right, as we will see. Further, it is not just religious minorities who have something to fear. Christian nationalism is linked to prejudice toward numerous minority groups. But strong Christian nationalists are declining in number, and this also has important implications. More and more Americans collectively agree that the United States should not favor Christianity formally. Consequently, the sizable portion of Americans who pine for Christianity's former prominence in American civic life feel threatened and marginalized. They fear that their values and priorities will, at best, no longer be dominant, and at worst, that their freedom to preach their moral values and share their religion with others would be outlawed. But readers should not mistake these fears as limited solely to religious identity. There is more to the us that Christian nationalists wish to defend, and more to the them that Christian nationalists wish to oppose. Throughout the book, we will show that the degree to which Americans seek to impose Christianity on the public sphere often operates as a powerful indicator of their commitment to a specific social order, with boundaries and hierarchies among natives and foreigners, whites and non-whites, men and women, heterosexuals and others, an order they recognize is also being threatened. How do we study Christian nationalism and Christian nationalists? Several important books, to which we are greatly indebted, have recently addressed the phenomenon of Christian nationalism, though not always by that name, in the United States. But to date, there have been no attempts to systematically and empirically examine Christian nationalism and its influence in American social, cultural, and political life. This is precisely what we do in this book, using large-scale, quantitative data to develop more reliable answers to questions about who Christian nationalists are and how Christian nationalism influences their lives. Each of the data sets we use includes important socio-demographic measures that allow us to isolate the unique influence of Christian nationalism, along with scores of questions concerning politics, religious, and racial or ethnic diversity, and family life and values. Several of the surveys also allow for comparisons over time. So, in addition to demonstrating Christian nationalism's significance in the current cultural moment, we will also explore shifts in its prevalence and importance. But numbers can only get us so far in understanding narratives of Christian nationalism. To better understand Christian nationalism and how people articulate and apply it, we draw on 50 in-depth interviews with Americans who, to varying degrees, endorse or challenge the privileging of Christianity in the civic life of the United States. We also engaged in participant observation at large events in Texas, Oklahoma, and South Carolina, where Christian nationalists and their beliefs were prominently represented. For more discussion of the specific data sets we use and how we conducted the interviews and participant observation, see Appendices A and C. So how do we measure Christian nationalism and Christian nationalists in our data? Definitions matter a great deal. Consider how narrowly or broadly we could define a Christian nationalist depending on the measures we use. Data from the 2017 Baylor Religion Survey, BRS, shows that 29% of Americans agree that the federal government should declare the United States a Christian nation. Even more Americans, 46%, agree that the federal government should advocate Christian values. Depending on the question we use, then, we could estimate that a quarter to half of Americans to some extent agree that the United States is a Christian nation, and the government should recognize this either formally or informally. In addition, in the same survey, 42% of Americans agreed that the success of the United States is a part of God's plan. Using slightly older data from 2013, almost two-thirds of Americans either mostly or completely agreed with the statement, "God has granted America a special role in human history." At the very least, we would conclude that a sizable proportion of Americans embrace the idea of a special relationship between God and the United States. Yet, the picture of what Christian nationalism is and who Christian nationalists are is still rather fuzzy. Let's see whether, by adding more detail, we can paint a clearer picture. In the 2017 BRS, 26% of Americans agreed that the United States has always been and currently is a Christian nation. Nearly one-third of Americans, 32%, believe that at some point in its past, the United States was a Christian nation, but is not anymore. A smaller number of Americans, 20%, report that America has never been a Christian nation, and still another fifth, 21%, couldn't say either way. See Figure I.1. The responses could be combined in several ways, depending on the story one would like to tell. If you define a Christian nationalist as anyone who believes the United States is currently or ever was a Christian nation, more than 3 out of every 5 Americans reside in this category. If it includes only those who currently see America as a Christian nation, the number is less than 3 in 10. While the question we use in Figure I.1 is useful in that it gives us a general idea of where Americans stand on the Christian nation narrative, it doesn't tell us how strongly Americans embrace Christian nationalism. Furthermore, Christian nationalism is not a single idea that can be measured solely by agreement with a founding myth, but rather a more dynamic ideology incorporating a number of beliefs and values. We want to know if Americans believe the United States should be a Christian nation, not just whether they think it is or was a Christian nation. Thus, to measure the concept as comprehensively as possible, we primarily use a composite measure created from multiple BRS survey questions from 2007 and 2017 that asked Americans to rate their levels of agreement with the following 6 statements. 1. The federal government should declare the United States a Christian nation. 2. The federal government should advocate Christian values. 3. The federal government should enforce strict separation of church and state. 4. The federal government should allow the display of religious symbols in public spaces. 5. The success of the United States is part of God's plan. 6. The federal government should allow prayer in public schools. For each statement, respondents could strongly disagree, disagree, agree, strongly agree, or indicate that they are undecided. Americans who believe the federal government should declare the United States a Christian nation, or who want the federal government to advocate explicitly Christian values, are obviously signaling a belief that Christianity and civil society should be intimately intertwined. These measures also tap into some of the cultural touchstone moments that have occurred in the recent past. For instance, various rulings from the United States Supreme Court on prayer in public schools or the display of religious symbols in public spaces have generated a great deal of response from the American public. Figure I.2 displays how Americans responded to each of these questions in the 2017 BRS. Comparing responses to these individual measures highlights that while 50-60% of Americans may agree or strongly agree with one of the 6 questions, fewer will answer consistently across all 6. In order to create the scale, we scored every answer on a scale from 0, strongly disagree, to 4, strongly agree. Therefore, any respondent who strongly agrees on all the measures would score a 24 on the Christian nationalism scale, and anyone who strongly disagrees with each of the statements would receive a 0 on the scale. Keep in mind, responses to the 3rd statement are reverse-coded. As readers can clearly see in Figure I.3, Americans are widely distributed all along the scale, meaning there is a great deal of variation across the population. There are several other observations that we can make about American support for Christian nationalism. First, just over 7% of the population strongly disagrees on every question. This shows that there is a subset of Americans who completely reject the idea of a close, symbiotic relationship between Christianity and American society. There are not, however, as many Americans who completely affirm this idea. Only 1% of Americans strongly agree with all the statements. Second, most Americans fall somewhere in the middle of the distribution. While a significant number place themselves at the upper and lower ends of the distribution, a majority are neither strongly opposed to nor strongly supportive of Christian nationalism. Third, Americans are not unevenly clumped at either end of the scale. Their support for Christian nationalism is widely distributed along the scale. Using the scale as a guide, we propose there are four main orientations toward Christian nationalism in the United States. Americans are either rejectors, resistors, accommodators, or ambassadors. We use these categories, intended as rough guidelines, not a rigid taxonomy, to explore patterns in Americans' diverse responses to Christian nationalism and the consequences of that ideology for public opinion and political behavior. Before we define these categories in the next chapter, though, we want to clearly define Christian nationalism and why we think it is different from both civil religion and religion writ large. Understanding Christian nationalism and its consequences. Simply put, Christian nationalism is a cultural framework, a collection of myths, traditions, symbols, narratives, and value systems that idealizes and advocates a fusion of Christianity with American civic life. But the Christianity of Christian nationalism is of a particular sort. We do not mean Christianity here as a general meta-category, including all expressions of Orthodox Christian theology. Nor will we use terms such as evangelicalism or white conservative Protestantism, to the extent that these represent certain theological interpretive positions, as synonyms for Christian nationalism. On the contrary, the Christianity of Christian nationalism represents something more than religion. As we will show, it includes assumptions of nativism, white supremacy, patriarchy, and heteronormativity, along with divine sanction for authoritarian control and militarism. It is as ethnic and political as it is religious. Understood in this light, Christian nationalism contends that America has been and should always be distinctively Christian, reflecting this fuller, more nuanced sense of the term from top to bottom, in its self-identity, interpretations of its own history, sacred symbols, cherished values, and public policies, and it aims to keep it that way. Several theological and ideological tributaries have shaped Christian nationalism into what we see today. Here, it is helpful to draw some critical distinctions between Christian nationalism and what has traditionally been thought of as America's civil religion. Civil religion represents America's dominant self-understanding and ethical lodestar. Its religious influences come primarily from the prophetic Old Testament tradition, in which God demands justice, mercy, and humility from His people, and from civic republicanism, a dynamic political philosophy emphasizing that civic virtue and a strong constitution that separates institutional powers are critical for maintaining free human societies. Though it has existed for just as long as America's civil religious tradition, Christian nationalism has been informed by different parts of the Bible. While civil religion has held that providence, the Creator, or nature's God demands our exemplary fairness, beneficence, and faithful stewardship if we are to retain our blessed inheritance, the Christian nationalist tradition, by contrast, views God's demands more in terms of allegiance to our national, almost ethnic, Christian identity. Christian nationalism is rarely concerned with instituting explicitly Christ-like policies or even policies reflecting New Testament ethics at all. Rather, Christian nationalists view God's expectations of America as akin to His commands to Old Testament Israel. Like Israel, then, America should fear God's wrath for unfaithfulness while assuming God's blessing or even mandate for subduing the continent by force if necessary. Finally, proponents of Christian nationalism have consistently viewed their mission through the lens of apocalyptic Christianity. A number of influential advocates of Christian nationalism could be characterized as postmillennial, meaning that they believe that Christ's kingdom is already established on earth, and thus his followers should bring every aspect of American.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.